So now we move on to a second talk, which is on management of constipation. To give this talk, I invite Dr. Lalit Bharadia, who is a very well-known pediatric gastroenterologist, especially in the western part of our country. He's a consultant pediatric gastroenterologist at Santokh Bhatt Durlabhji Memorial Hospital at Jaipur. And his chief interests are in celiac disease, therapeutic GI endoscopy in pediatric diseases. And he has multiple publications to his credit. So now I hand over the proceedings to Dr. Lalit Bharadia, sir, for his talk on management of constipation in children.
Good afternoon, friends. Thank you for the kind introduction, Dr. Vikrant. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity. The topic given to me is management of childhood constipation. Okay, so when it comes to management of childhood constipation, there are several dilemmas which comes into the mind of a clinician, whether I am dealing with a functional or an organic constipation. We know Rome criteria help us to distinguish, but they are difficult to remember and sometimes confusing, whether we follow a step down or a step up approach, which laxative to choose among the basket of variety of laxatives, whether to investigate or not. And of course, there is a thin line between the optimum or a desired effect and the side effect. With this, let us start the presentation. The commonest cause of constipation in children is functional constipation, and it contributes to almost 95%. So we should remember to distinguish functional constipation from organic. How do we confirm functional constipation? We can take help of Rome 4 criteria. No need to remember all of them, but they can be kept as a, you know, in front of, in your mobile, or, you know, in front of your, on the table of your consultation chamber. If any two of these 6 criteria are present for a minimum period of 1 month, in the absence of red flags, we can give a positive diagnosis of functional constipation. And what are the red flags? There are several red flags. The important one on history is any child who has delayed passage of meconium, wherein passage of meconium beyond 48 hours, any child who has significant abdominal distension, failure to thrive, any child who has abnormal examination in the form of abnormal thyroid, abnormal position of the anus, abnormal cremastic or abnormal lower limb reflexes, or any sacral dimple or tuft of hair at the lower spine, should make you worry that this is indeed likely to be an organic constipation, and they should be subjected to proper investigation. The management of functional constipation after having confirmed by Rome criteria and absence of red flag symptoms and signs involves following steps. It starts with counseling. Explain why does the child has constipation. You may take help of a diagram. Then come the pharmacological treatment, then proper toilet training, optimization of the diet and activity, and of course the psychosocial support. In the education, it is important we explain why the child has constipation. Child should not be blamed for soiling. We have to explain them the management of constipation will take longer than they would really want, and compliance to medication is very important. An optimum dose will be unpredictable for any child, and hence close titration of the doses will be recommended, required in the first few weeks to months of treatment. Once we have explained them, then the compliance is likely to be better. The first step involves disinfection, because more than 50% of functional constipation in children, they have impacted stool. Disinfection helps the rectum and the colon to achieve its normal diameter and normal reflexes. The subsequent treatment becomes easy. Oral route of disinfection is preferred over rectal route, because oral route is non-invasive and it acts on the entire colon, whereas rectal, despite apart from being invasive, it acts on the limited part of the colon. Like suppository will act only on the rectum, enema will act only on the sigmoid, rectosigmoid part of the colon, and maybe part of the descending colon, and hence oral is the preferred. When it comes to oral disinfection, there are two ways One is hospital based, where it has 100% success. The other is home based, where it is almost 70 to 90% success. How do I choose? Hospital based is preferred for a child who stays far off from your working place, who finds it difficult to come to hospital frequently, where the parents are not educated to titrate the dose at home, and one who has very severe impacted stool. For them, we admit them in a daycare. The polyethylene glycol is the preferred solution, is made to run via nasogastric tube at the rate of 25 ml per kg per hour. Dose can be slightly increased every hour to a maximum of 1 liter per hour till the effluent is clear. Generally, the result is achieved in 4 to 6 hours. For those who stay close by, where the follow-up is possible, where the family will be able to titrate the dose at home, home-based disinfection is preferred. Again, the same molecule is preferred in the dose of 1.5 to 2 gram per kg per day, and the dose is recommended to be increased every 3 to 6 days till the effluent is clear, and the desired effect is generally achieved in 1 to 2 weeks. Once the disinfection is done, we start the maintenance therapy. Osmotic laxatives are the preferred laxatives for maintenance therapy, and the two main important laxatives in this category are polyethylene glycol and lactulose. The dose need to be titrated to get the optimum result, that is 1 to 2 soft stool per day, and the toilet training has to be achieved before we plan to taper the laxatives. Initially, the child will need a close follow-up, and then maybe every monthly or maybe quarterly follow-up will be sufficient. Dose and activity need to be optimized during this phase. So these are several list of laxatives. I won't go into the detail, but the important one, as I said, polyethylene glycol and lactulose are the preferred osmotic laxatives. Other include mineral oil, milk of magnesia. In the stimulant category, we have bisacodyl, senna, and sodium picosulfate. The stimulant categories are drugs are recommended only when you have a relapse of constipation while he is stable on osmotic laxatives during maintenance phase, or during initial disinfection when the stools are really hard or the infection is significant, or during preparation of colonoscopy. Apart from that, stimulant laxatives are not to be used, and certainly not to be used for a long-term basis. Enema also have a limited role, especially during the acute phase when to get the symptomatic immediate relief, and they should not be used on a SOS basis or on a regular basis. And among the enema, we have saline and sodium phosphate. We need to remember the maximum doses of several laxatives. The phosphate enema, the maximum dose is 2.5 ml per kg, and it has to be given only once a day, should not be repeated on the same day. And saline enema, the maximum dose is 6 ml per kg. It can be repeated twice in a day. Bisacodyl, the maximum dose is, the recommended dose is 5 mg per day for children beyond 3 years of age. And for beyond 10 years, the dose is 10 mg per day. It has to be given only on OD doses. We also need to know the age beyond which different laxatives are approved. So lactulose and sodium picosulfate are approved as young as 1 month of age. Polyethylene glycol is approved beyond 6 months of age. However, for practical purposes, because polyethylene glycol has to be dissolved in certain amount of water, this is a challenge in less than 2 years of age. Liquid paraffin is not recommended in first year of age because of the risk of aspiration and lipoid pneumonia. Senna is recommended beyond 2 years, and bisacodyl beyond 3 years of age. Behavioral modification while the child is on maintenance therapy include routine toilet sitting. So a preschool child should be encouraged to sit on toilet seat 3 times a day after all major meals, 5 minutes after meal for 5 minutes. And the child should be rewarded for sitting and doubly rewarded for sitting and passing stool. There should be no punishment if the child doesn't pass stool. The toilet training ideally started at 2 years of age, where the child is encouraged to sit in the toilet seat 2 to 3 times a day. And squatting position is preferred in an Indian style. Where it is not possible, child can sit on the English potty seat, provided the knees are at a level higher than the hips and the feet are not dangling in the air. This will facilitate proper expulsion. Diet need to be optimized in the form of adequate fiber and adequate fluid intake, water intake. The fiber recommended is age in years multiplied by 2 or age in years plus 5. This is the amount of gram of fiber to be consumed every day. And to know how much diet gives how much fiber, I'll give you certain examples. So 100 grams of most of the fruits will give 2 to 3 grams of fiber, whereas 100 grams of most of the salad items will give 4 to 6 grams of fiber, and 100 grams of green leafy vegetables will give 6 to 10 grams of fiber. So roughly, green leafy vegetables will give double the amount of fiber as salads, and salads will give double the amount of fiber as fruits. And certain constipated food need to be avoided. They include dairy products, chocolates, bakery products, junk foods, which comes in very attractive packages, diet predominant in starch. As minimum as possible, these diet should be consumed so that, you know, we are able to help with lesser amount of pharmacotherapy. When child doesn't respond despite conventional treatment for 3 months, we label it as refractory constipation, and these are the subset of children who need referral and further investigation. And based on the manometry or marker study, the three different motility pattern described are the outlet tract obstruction, slow transit constipation, and normal transit constipation. Understanding the motility is important because the treatment for them is different. Outlet tract obstruction, they are treated better with biofeedback. Slow transit will need an added therapy in the form of an electrical stimulation or an ACE procedure, and normal transit will need the standard treatment to be continued. Certain newer formulations are available now for those where compliance is an issue. The lactulose is available in the form of a gummy, and probiotic with or without prebiotic is available in the form of stick. These are apart from the conventional tablets, syrups, and powder preparation which are available. Certain newer molecules are available which provide some hope in time to come. They are at the moment very effective in adult. In time to come, they will be also applicable to children. We are using them, some of them, in children beyond 12 years. So we have serotonin agonist, example prucalopride. It is a colonic prokinetic. We have secretagogue, which are chloride channel activators like lubiprostone and linaclotide. And apart from these, the still newer are the bile acid recycling modifiers and sodium hydrogen exchange inhibitors. Novel therapies for constipation, especially the slow transit constipation, is the ACE procedure, where it is antegrade colonic enema, which is done by the surgical colleague. It can also be done by endoscopic cecostomy method, the way we do percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy. We have transcutaneous electric stimulation tests, where a belt with electrode is applied over the abdomen. It was initially used to treat urinary incontinence, and later on it was found that it worked very well for constipation as well. Sacral nerve stimulation is a little invasive procedure, where a surgeon puts the electrode close to the sacral nerve, and depending upon the desired effect, whether we want a parasympathetic or a sympathetic effect, we can optimize for the benefit of constipation. So carry your message. Functional constipation is the most common cause of constipation in children. Rome criteria and red flags help differentiate functional constipation from organic. Education of the family and counseling is very important to ensure they are compliant to the treatment and the treatment is successful. We need to assess whether there is infection and treat and do disinfection before we start maintenance. We need to start treatment early, and we will have to continue for months to years. And while we do that, we need to optimize the diet and activity and toilet training before we plan to gradually taper and wean them off. Thank you. With this, I would like to recommend this ISPGHAN guideline on functional childhood constipation, which was published in Indian Pediatrics in October 2018. It gives in detail information as to how to manage these children with functional constipation. Thank you.